This is the section, why is there something rather than nothing? And like I said earlier, sometimes people now with the multiverse theory, they would say, why is there something instead of everything? Because with multiverse theory, there could be so many universes and alternate universes and all that. So let me ask you one question about this. I don't know. Let me give it to you. What would you like to say? What would you like to say to the atheists about this?
About the idea of why is there something rather than nothing?
Yeah, you know, the way I see it is that you really have two options. Either the universe, everything popped out of nothing, or else something always existed. And the problem is that neither one of them makes sense to us humans because we cannot observe either one of those happening. We cannot understand what it is. And personally, I think I would lean towards that something always existed. And that's the way I would lean. That would be like the multiverse theory or something, but not this intelligent being that created everything.
Yeah, well, okay, that's interesting. Yeah, the way I guess I like to think about that whole question is I'm not so sure I find, quite frankly, the question, why is there something rather than nothing, compelling, because in a sense, if there was nothing, then there would be no way that we would know that there was nothing. So I've never found that particular question compelling one way or the other. But on the other hand, the idea of the fact that we see that at least the universe that we can observe for all that we understand seems to have a beginning. And my point would be that at minimum lines up with the idea of creation ex nihilo, which I think is taught, for example, in Genesis 1:1 or Hebrews 11:3. And so I would say that the fact that we discover a beginning to the universe is consistent with the idea that the ideas that we see in Scripture, and if there is a beginning, there must be something outside the universe, at least that we can observe, that caused the universe. And I think you're right to point out that it could either be a multiverse or it could be a personal creator. But ultimately, both you and I would have to posit an uncaused cause. So if you're embracing a multiverse, interestingly enough, even all viable multiverse theories require a beginning to the multiverse, so you really don't escape the problem of a beginning. But
well, I wouldn't agree with that. The multiverse is totally beyond comprehension. You can't say it requires a beginning.
Well, but people have done mathematical modeling to try to explain phenomena within this universe that would be consistent with the idea of a multiverse, and all the models that are reasonable models basically require a beginning, and that's something that's been well established by theoretical physicists, as much as you could establish ideas like that.
Well, I would strongly argue against that. I mean, I take, for example, Einstein came up with this space-time fabric idea. And, you know, prior to Einstein, people thought space and time were two different things. And so with space-time, everything has changed. And when you look at, like, quantum entanglement, that supposedly you can entangle two particles and separate them across the universe, and when you modify one, the other one's modified. Nothing travels faster than the speed of light, we know, and physicists say they are clueless about how these things are connected. They have no. One physicist said it's like we don't even know we don't know anything. We don't even know the fabric of reality here. So there is so much unknown here. So to me, it seems ridiculous to say that. Well, you know, multiverse theory would have to be true about the multiverse. I mean, we have so much unknowns.
And all I'm pointing out is what theoretical physicists who work on this problem have concluded, and there's a great book that we have available through our organization called "Who's Afraid of the Multiverse?" written by an astrophysicist who's looked into this idea of the multiverse, Jeff Zwirink, and he basically argues that and points to the scientific literature, that every model for the multiverse that, again, would be considered to be a reasonable model by theoretical physicists demands a beginning to the multiverse. People who are arguing, you know, like you would argue that there was always something, would say that, that prior to the universe, this is Lawrence Krauss and Stephen Hawking would argue that there was this eternally existing gravitational field, and out of that field you can explain the multiverse and then hence our local universe. But ultimately they're positing an uncaused cause that brought everything into existence. And that's, I would argue, is metaphysically equivalent to a Christian positing an uncaused cause that was a personality that brought everything into existence.
It seems to me that you're wrong in saying that they, like Lawrence Krauss says, that there was a field that generated the multiverse. I think he was saying there's a field that generated the Big Bang, for example, but not the multiverse.
No, I think it's the multiverse.
I disagree with you there. I don't think they say anything about the multiverse. I think you're confusing the origin of this universe with multiverse.
Well, regardless, the point that I'm making is that everybody has to posit an uncaused cause in order to, you can't get away from having an uncaused cause, because nothing, if you're looking at things in a strictly naturalistic perspective, there is never a point where there's nothing, and that nothing then causes something. There's always something that exists that ultimately is the ultimate cause. And again, that's functionally equivalent to a Christian perspective, that there was a creator that brought everything into existence, that and that creator was uncaused.
Okay, I got to ask you a question. This is kind of like, I think I can make a comedy routine out of this question, I think, so I want to see how you answer it. You're saying that God is the uncaused cause. He's eternally existing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Imagine if you're God. God is supposed to know everything, but one thing he doesn't know is how he came to be. It's like he just found himself existing. He didn't make himself. So it's like, what a lucky guy this is. How did he just, he just happened to find himself existing. Isn't that crazy?
Well, you know, I guess I would respond to your question in a similar way that you are to use a point that you made earlier about quantum entanglement, that there are things going on in this universe that we don't seem to have a clue or an understanding of, and that we may not have the capability of ever understanding things that comprise the universe, or ever having explanations for things that comprise the universe, and so in a sense we have a very, we have a finite capacity, and so, when we ask ourselves questions about God and God's eternal nature, in a sense, it's a category that we have no experience that helps us even to begin to comprehend what that is. And so it may be that the question that you're asking, which to you and I seems to be like a really good question, may actually be an absurd statement if we had the wherewithal to appreciate what it was like to be an eternally existing being.
I'm just thinking, neither one of us created ourselves. We gradually emerge and we find ourselves existing. And it's like, well, this is me and that's you. What if you would have found yourself to be God and said like, oh, wow, I don't know how I came about, but it's me,
But I guess if you were an eternally existing being, that may be a question that you never would even ask. That, in other words, our experience is that things all have an origin, that things have a point where they come into existence, and there is a point where, if you're a sentient being, that you have an awareness that you came into existence. But if you were an eternal being, that just simply may not be something that, again, categorically you would ever even entertain, because it would be an absurdity from that perspective. So,
but he doesn't know how he came to exist. I mean, it's the same question. Why is there something rather than nothing? Why is there God instead of nothing? Why isn't there just nothing? Well, why is there a God? Why is there stuff? How did God find himself existing?
Well, I mean, you could even ask the same question. Well, why? why would there be a multiverse, or why would there be, you know, an eternally existing gravitational field?
Right. You know, but, you know, but in some ways, though, it's really weird to think about, but maybe it all equals out to nothing in the end. I mean, like, for example, in algebra, you could have 0 = 0. Well, you could add 5 to both. You could add 5 to one side and put 2 + 3 on the other side. You have actually different numbers, but you still have 0. But there's, you know, so you can pop up with a 5 = 5, but, you know, in different forms, but in the end, it's equal. So maybe that's the way reality is. Maybe, you know, time came into existence at some point, and it's going to be gone. Here we are just passing through this time that was created. I mean, yeah, there's just so much we don't understand. I mean, like with quantum mechanics, we just don't even understand the fabric of reality, it seems like.
Well, and I guess, you know, my point would be, given what we are capable of understanding, you know, what kind of conclusions can we draw about the nature of reality and the nature of humanity, given what we know? And in a sense, that's all we can do, is to try to make sense of reality based on what we know. And, you know, and I would maintain that, given everything that we know, it's at minimum reasonable to think that there is a creator that's personal, that brought everything into existence. And I think it's rational to embrace the Christian faith. I don't know that, I'll just leave it at that.
Okay.